Hi, my name is Louis Massarelli. I'm the pastor here at Glad Tidings, and I just want to say thank you for joining us. Thanks for tuning in, if you're tuning in at a time other than Sunday morning. But thank you for joining us, and thank you for being a part of the service. We're going to worship, we're going to hear from God's Word, we're going to pray together, we're going to just spend some time honoring God. So do this, sing, and enjoy God's presence, even as you are there at home or wherever you are listening to this. God bless you.
O Lord, our Lord, your majestic name fills the earth. Your glory is higher than the heavens. You have taught children and infants to tell your strength, silencing your enemies and all who oppose you. When I look at the night sky and see the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you set in place, what are mere mortals that you should think about them? Human beings that you should care for them? Yet you made them only a little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You gave them charge of everything you made, putting all things under their authority, the flocks and the herds and all the wild animals, the birds in the sky, the fish in the sea, and everything that swims the ocean currents. O Lord, our Lord, your majestic name fills the earth. Let the godly sing for the joy to the Lord. It is fitting for the pure to praise him. For the word of the Lord holds true, and we can trust everything he does. He loves whatever is just and good. The unfailing love of the Lord fills the earth. The Lord merely spoke, and the heavens were created. He breathed the word, and all the stars were born. He assigned the seas its boundaries and locked the oceans in vast reservoirs. Let the whole world fear the Lord, and let everyone stand in awe of him. For when he spoke, the world began. It appeared at his command. But the Lord's plans stand firm forever. His intentions can never be shaken. The Lord looks down from heaven and sees the whole human race. From his throne, he observes all who live on the earth. The Lord watches over those who fear him, those who rely on his unfailing love. He rescues them from death and keeps them alive in times of famine. We put our hope in the Lord. He is our help and our shield. In him, our hearts rejoice, for we trust in his holy name. Let your unfailing love surround us, Lord, for our hope is in you alone.
Sky, let it rise, let it rise. From the dark into light, now alive. We are here to lift you up, here to sing a song of love, here to give you, God, all you are worthy of. It's a holy roar, reaching for heaven, a praise poured out with a reckless abandon. Our worship, God, is wholly yours. Here we stand, here we wait. Have your way, have your way. Every hand in this place, God, we raise. raise. We are here to lift you up, here to sing a song of love, here to give you, God, what you are worthy of. A holy roar, it's reaching for heaven. Our praise poured out with reckless abandon. Our worship, God, is wholly yours. Well, we are wholly yours. Forever worthy, forever worthy, forever worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Forever worthy, forever worthy, forever worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Forever worthy, forever worthy, forever worthy, forever worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Hear this holy roar, it's reaching for heaven. Our praise poured out with a reckless abandon. Our worship, God, is wholly yours. When we are wholly yours, to you our holy roar, it's reaching for heaven. Our praise poured out with a reckless abandon. Our worship, God, is wholly yours. Well, we are wholly yours. Well, all the earth, the holy roar, lifting up a holy roar. All the earth a holy roar. We're lifting up a holy roar. All the earth a holy roar. Lifting up a holy roar. Tasted and tasted your grace, and was so lost till I fell at the cross and got saved. Oh, I got saved. I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. Got a hold of my life. I got Jesus. Could I want more? The love of God will claim me His pardon. The love of God won't let me stay the same. The love of God calls me up higher. His will is stronger. It's why I got saved. The love of God gave me His pardon. The love of God won't let me stay the same. The love of God calls me up higher. His will is stronger. It's why I got saved. I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. Got a hold of my life. I've got Jesus. Could I want more? I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. Restored and made right. Got a hold of my life. I've got Jesus. Could I want more? The love of God gave me His pardon. The love of God won't let me stay the same. The love of God calls me up higher. His will is stronger. It's why I got saved. I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. Got a hold of my life. I've got Jesus. Could I want more? I've got Jesus. Could I want more? I've got Jesus. Could I want more? Set free, I've been set free. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see You now. Oh, I can see the love in Your eyes. Laying Yourself down, raising up the broken to life. Take our weakness. You set Your treasure in jars of clay. So take this heart, Lord. I'll be Your vessel. soul the world to see your life in me. Oh, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. God, we are so thankful for your love. We are so thankful for your grace, Lord. Lord, we have all sinned. We've all fallen short of your glory. But God, your grace, your love, your forgiveness, Lord God, covers our sin. You make us whole again. So Lord God, even in this moment, may you just meet us where we're at. Lord, there are times, Lord, that we need to just come before you and confess. Lord, even in this moment, before we move on any farther in this service, God, may we just get right with you, Lord God. Search us and know us. Know if there's anything in us, Lord God, that displeases you. And then, Lord God, set us on that path of everlasting. Lord God, restore unto us the joy of our salvation. And then, Lord God, in your grace, in your mercy, Lord, you invite us. You invite us to come boldly, as the writer of Hebrews says, to come boldly into your throne room, to come boldly into your presence, Lord God, and we can bring our needs and our cares before you. So God, right now, any needs that are represented, Lord, there are so many health issues right now, Lord God. So many cases that we're aware of people who are going through treatment for cancer, who have been diagnosed with cancer, who have loved ones who they're supporting who have cancer. Lord God, we pray that
in your name, in Jesus' name, you just come and minister to those lives right now. Lord God, for Jason, Lord, I know he's concluded his treatment, but yet, Lord God, we just pray that you continue to just bring strength to his body, strength to his spirit. Lord God, specifically for Annette's mother right now, Lord God, this diagnosis that she was given, I pray you just give comfort and peace for that whole family, Lord God. Lord God, bring the peace that passes all understanding, Lord God. That, Lord, even as there are situations where we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we will not fear any evil. Lord God, you are with us and you lead us by streams of water. You bring life to us. And Lord, that is the hope that we have. That's the hope that this world needs to see. Lord, that even in the rough situations, even in the hardships of life, there's a perseverance. There's a steadfast spirit that you've given us. And it doesn't come from ourselves, but it comes from you. Lord God, for any emotional needs right now, Lord God, people are struggling with depression, Lord God. People are struggling just with mental health issues and just the exhaustion of this season. God, I pray that in this new year, you just breathe fresh life and fresh presence into our lives. Lord God, that we might know you in a fresh and new way, that we might know you in a deeper way than we did last year. Lord, I pray that this year you put people on our hearts, Lord, and we just bring that hope and we're carriers of the truth and carriers of your name to the people around us. Lord, for the message that we're about to hear, God, may our hearts and our minds and our spirits be open to your word. It's living and active, Lord God. It does a work that's so amazing, Lord God, that just ink and paper, Lord God, the words of life that come alive in our spirit, and your Holy Spirit just confirms in us, Lord God, that this is the truth. You are the truth, and the truth will set us free. So Jesus, have your way today. May your word go forth in power. In your precious and holy name, amen.
Last week, we looked at three reasons why we should persevere. And not just because we're going through this challenging time with COVID-19 and the lockdown, but because we are commanded to persevere whatever our lot is in life, as Scripture says. So no matter what we have to endure, Christ wants us to persevere. And there's some really good reasons for it. But we have been stressed on all sides right now. Just like I imagine the Apostle Paul was, or at least in a similar fashion, because he said in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, he says, we were under great pressure, far beyond our ability to endure, so that we despised of life itself. Indeed, we felt we did receive the sentence of death. But this happened so that we might not rely on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. Just listen to the news, to your families, your friends, your neighbors. Everyone has it tough, from parents who have to teach kids online while they're working and it's just so chaotic, to others not being able to see loved ones because of travel restrictions. It's a challenging time right now. Then there's the stress of the people who are on people who are essential workers. They're out on the front lines each and every day. I'm sure they're concerned about the potential they have to jeopardize their family's health when they get back home. And what about the people who think that this is all a big hoax? And they feel safe and they don't follow the rules because there's so little infection in our area. And on we can go. Different scenarios, different people. But all the same, we are hurting. We are pushed. We are pressured on all sides during this pandemic. And I'm not wanting to in any way minimize mental health. If you have a challenge with mental health and that's overwhelming you, find some help. Call Pastor Nathan or myself or your doctor. Talk to someone who you trust. But I'm talking in this message and the one last week about pressures that we have that are put upon us, and we need to stand up under them. We need to persevere. As Christ followers, we must have hope, as we discussed briefly last week, because there's others around us who need the peace that God brings us. We must persevere during these times that we are facing. Today, I want to look at just a few more reasons why we must persevere. But first, I want to briefly review the three that we talked about last week. Just quickly here, the first of those was we need to persevere because it's the chief way that we resist the devil. And the second reason we gave was we need to persevere because it's essential for our growing character in Christ Jesus. And the third reason we talked about last week is that we need to persevere because it encourages others towards Christ. Now, I've been laying out these reasons why we need to persevere. A little later, we're going to get into how we persevere. But first, let me continue with a few more why we must persevere. So the fourth reason we need to persevere is it's the only way we complete everything that we have been given to do. Many of you are at or in retirement years. Finishing well is an important concept we all face when we think about retirement. Life coaches and mentors have sprung up in the last 30 years hailing that it's important to finish well. Actually, the Bible's been talking about that for centuries. In 2019, Lauren Robinson spoke to us, and he just briefly commented on the fact that the word retirement isn't even in the Bible. And it's not really, he challenged us with the thought that it's not even a concept that Christ followers should dwell on. Finishing well is important to the spiritual life just as it is to the work life. Last week, I quickly mentioned how many Christians just give up before a victory. And there's really no time when we should quit in the way of finishing all that God has set before us to do. God has a unique plan or a race or a purpose for each of our lives. God actually planned when in history each of us would be born, as well as where we would be born. In Ephesians, Paul tells us that God has a plan for us, which he expects us to complete. Ephesians 2 verse 10 says this, "For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." God has a unique race for you to run. Hebrews 12 verse 1 says, "Therefore, since we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us." Now, this is really where the whole idea of finishing well, this is the biblical side of it. Concerning David, Luke said in Acts chapter 13, when David had served God's purpose in his own generation, he fell asleep. He was buried with his fathers, and his body decayed. So there really isn't any spiritual retirement savings plan, an SRSP, so to speak. For people who follow Christ, we finish the work God has for us to accomplish, and then we fall asleep. Sometimes, however, in that process of pursuing his plans or the race that he's marked out for us, it includes trials and sufferings that might threaten us or derail us or try to keep us from finishing well, much like many of us are feeling with COVID-19. Last week, I mentioned the words that God spoke about his plan for Paul's life in Acts chapter 9, verse 15 and 16. It says, "But the Lord said to Ananias, 'Go to this man. He is my chosen instrument to carry my name among the Gentiles and their kings and before the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name.' Yet, despite the overwhelming hardship, opposition, persecution, difficulties that Paul had throughout his life, he set a goal, and it was to persevere, to complete the task that God had given him. Acts chapter 20, verse 24, he says this, 'How I consider my life worth nothing to me, if only I may finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the gospel of God's grace.'" At the end of his life, Paul looked back with satisfaction, knowing that he had indeed completed the mission given to him by the Lord. 2 Timothy, this was one of the last books that he wrote. 2 Timothy 4, 7 to 8. "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing." Unfortunately, as I mentioned before, many Christians quit their life calling or their assignment or the race before time. After all, we're a generation of quitters, aren't we? I remember in eighth grade, I quit the soccer team because the peer captain told me to run another lap around the goalposts, and I had finished first when the whole team was doing it, and he says, "Lewis, do it again," and I just didn't like that, and so I quit the team. People quit their roles of leadership. People quit their marriages. People quit and they drop out of church. They quit their jobs when the boss tells them to do something they don't want to do. People quit praying. People get hurt, they get discouraged, and they quit. Many start, that's the easy part. But fewer finish. Yet God calls all of us to persevere. He calls us to finish what he has given us to do. It's not just full-time missionaries or full-time pastors. He is calling to finish the work he designed for us to do. He's calling normal people, like you and me, everyday people, everybody who calls by the name of Jesus. He wants us to finish what he has called us to do. Whatever he has given you to do, do it. Persevere to the end. My father-in-law, at age 92, is a great example of one who perseveres. He grew up from a teen working in the textile industry in Montreal, and as a trade, he learned how to be a cutter. That is, he cut out material for patterns to be sewn and for men's clothing primarily. And he worked his way up from the cutting floor to managing all of production in a number of firms. And after retiring almost 40 years ago now, he still does work at home in his garage, cutting suits. And actually, he's done it as a side hustle his whole career. He would cut suits for people and then send them out to get sewn, men's clothing, women's clothing. He'd repair things. And all of those years of standing on concrete production floors in factories wore out his knees and his hip. Over 20 years ago, he had two knees replaced and a hip replaced. Uh, he he's now eligible for replacement surgery. Even a few years ago, they said he was too old and they would not operate on him. And due to that, he endures. Still working in his garage, cutting cloth. And what he found about 12 years ago, he found a great thing to do. Actually, he began helping his wife's church sewing team. My mother-in-law is a group of women that meet together at the church and they sew clothes. This was before shutdown, of course, but they sew clothes for orphans in the Ukraine. And so my father-in-law continues to this day, even because the women now take the clothes home to sew instead of meeting at the church, he cuts cloth for them. And though he's in constant pain, he lives with it because he realizes that he's not finished here on earth. And he realizes that there's kids in Ukraine that actually need his skill set. They need him to cut some cloth so these other women can sew some cloth and make outfits for them. He perseveres. You know, like, I bump my elbow and I go, oh, I gotta stop for an hour, you know. But he perseveres through the pain that he's feeling. He describes it as constant, and if he stops, if he doesn't persevere, he knows it would be crippling to him. What have you been called to finish? Persevere in it. Here's the fifth reason we should persevere. It's because it inspires others to persevere. Now, I read Hebrews 12, verse 1 earlier, but let me add a few verses to that. Hebrews 12, 1 to 3. Therefore, since we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, and the author here is talking about chapter 11 of Hebrews, where he lists all these people, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. Notice that the writer wants us to consider the people who have gone before us. The great cloud of witness from Hebrews chapter 11. And in doing that, we fix our eyes on Jesus and the author and the finisher, the one who completed our faith journey. Why? Because they inspire. Jesus inspires. Those people from Hebrews chapter 11 inspire us to finish well. They inspire us to persevere. When I hear stories of miracles that God has done in people's lives, wow, I'm inspired. But you know what? When I hear stories of people who persevere, though there's opposition, though there's hardship, though there's loss, I'm even more inspired. One of those people in my life is a missionary by the name of Ed Dixon. Now, he's spoken at our church before. He hails from Canada's southernmost town, Kingsville, Ontario. He earned a master's degree in 1988, and he worked as a bank manager for 2 years. And then as an advisor to the Canadian government for 5 years. Then he was hired by one of Canada's largest universities as an associate director. When he was 32 years old, he was traveling around the world as a government consultant and making more money than he had ever dreamed of. Then one night, God told Ed to move to Ukraine and to make that his home. And he obeyed, and he left everything to go to Ukraine and to help orphans. So fast forward. Now, he has the ear of the president of Ukraine. He meets regularly with the president's wife to discuss social programs and helping the poor and the marginalized of Ukraine. He influences policy, in essence, because he's built relationship with these people, and he loves the Ukrainian people, and he will do anything for them because God told him to do this. But to get there, he endured many challenges. His marriage fell apart here in Canada. He left a great job. He left great earning potential. And he had to move to another country where he didn't know the language. He had to learn a new language. He had to raise financial support, which is something that he never had to do. But he persevered in what God called him to accomplish. And Ed is a great inspiration to me. And each of you have your own Eds. You have the people in your life who inspire you. Or you can just look at Hebrews chapter 11, and that lists a bunch of people who were successful in following God, and they saw God's promises. And actually, then it lists some who didn't see God's promises, but they still persevered. And then it lists some who actually died for the sake of the cross, in essence, for Jesus. They kept doing what they were called to do. They persevered in the face of difficulties. 6, we need to persevere because through it we obtain the answers to our prayers and experience fruitfulness in our lives. I sometimes wonder how many times we have been on the brink, right at the edge of receiving answers to our prayer, and we just give up and we quit. Jesus told his disciples in Luke chapter 18, verse 1, told them a parable to show them that they should always pray and not give up. Persevering prayer is the key to seeing some of our most significant prayers answered. And it is also the key to seeing fruit come in our lives. Many have given up just before they were about to enter a period of fruitfulness. Have I ever told you that I often have felt like quitting Glad Tidings? Oh, and not just once, maybe it's every second month. And I pray, oh please, Jesus, help me. Help me lead this church. So I can't do it alone. And I pray for souls, and I pray for people to get saved, and I pray for people's desire to get deepened and strengthened in the Lord. I pray for disciples, and in my weakness, I don't see the results right in front of me, and it just makes me want to quit. Then God reminds Lydia and me that we have to persevere. And inevitably, as soon as we do, we get a phone call from someone who says they've been struggling with something, and then they've learned to give it to God, and they just wanted to share that with us. Oh. Or we're reminded by someone who sends us a card or an email or a text and says that God is changing their life and doing something in their life. Or it's once a month, I come home from a board meeting, and board meetings are some of my favorite time of the month. It's just amazing. We have a great church board. Church family, you don't know how dedicated these people are to you, to prayer, to loving you, to working diligently, to be God's people in leadership. And I just have the privilege of working with them. Pastor Nathan and I often just talk about how awesome it is to work with this board. Don't quit praying and believing, because the answer could be on its way. You might just not see it right now, but it's there. In Daniel chapter 10, the prophet was praying, Daniel the prophet, he was praying because, and the answer wasn't showing up for 3 weeks. He kept praying for the same thing over and over and over. But we read on and we find out that it was held up in the spiritual realm. You could read the story in Daniel chapter 10. We live in a world that is as real spiritually as it is physically. Daniel finally received answers to his prayer because he persevered and didn't give up praying. And Paul tells us clearly in Galatians chapter 6, verse 9, let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. We must persevere to see the answers to our prayers and to see fruitfulness in our lives. Again this week, we've all seen more unsettling things in the news. I guess we can use the word unprecedented again. The American Congress building was stormed by demonstrators in an effort to stop the counting of the electoral votes. On this grim last days picture that we have, a reminder for all of us, as if COVID-19 isn't a big enough reminder for us and all the baggage that it carries, that the return of the Lord is ever so approaching. And it is on many levels. Talk about one world government, talk about technology that we'll have to wear or implant, financial and medical systems and scientific systems and university systems. All of this, they're becoming more and more visible to us for what we see in Revelation to be played out. But what does that mean to you and me? Paul writes this to the church in Thessalonica, and I just love it. Chapter 2, he says, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered to him, we ask you, brothers and sisters, not to become easily unsettled or alarmed. He called you to this through our gospel, that you might share in the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. So then, brothers and sisters, stand firm, persevere, and hold fast to the teachings we have passed on to you, whether by word of mouth or by letter. We are in the last days, and we must persevere. We need to finish well. Jesus told us what to do to prepare for his return. In Matthew 25, he tells us the parable of the man who goes away and he gives his money to three people. He gives one, for argument's sake, a $5 bill, another one he gives a $2 bill, and to another one he gives a loony. And the one who did nothing with his money, the one who had the loony, he didn't even invest it in the bank to get interest. That person was shamed, and he was thrown away out of God's presence. But the other two took the $5 and $2, and they put the money to work. And they worked with that money, they invested it, and they did things with it. And when they came, their master came back, they shared the profits with him, and they were welcomed into the master's kingdom. We must be about the very thing that God wants us to do. We must persevere until he comes. We're going to do a listening time again this morning. We're going to ask God a really important question. So I want you just to unplug yourself from everything that's around you and just try to try to isolate yourself as best you can with family around you. Let's all try to do this exercise together. We're going to quiet ourselves and we're going to ask God this question. What have you called me to finish? Maybe you feel like giving up. Maybe you just can't go on. There's just so much pressure in your life and in the people around you, and your this crisis of COVID is bearing down on you. Ask God, what is it that he has called you to finish. Amen. Press on. Persevere. Let's listen. Ask him this question. Identified it, take it to heart, persevere. And now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Thank you so much for listening. If this is the first time you've connected with us, drop us a line at info@gdpcbirth.com or go onto our webpage and find us and let us know that you've tracked with us here. Thank you so much for being here.